Welcome back, guys, to Not Crossover. I'm Mark and Mark here, your host for tonight. We're going to finish off the segment talking about the Raptors. James, what do we got for our topics?
So what do you think of Raptors right now? Like, do you think they should change things up or should...
I want to throw it back at you because, like, 7-1 right now in February. Yeah. So it might even actually be a little different than that, but, like, they've been playing well in February. Yeah. And sometimes Kawhi is injured, but it doesn't necessarily matter. Yeah. Right, because you can see how deep this team is right now.
Yeah, exactly. Like I said, they're 13-4, so something is working. But a lot of fans are scared of like Bucks or scared of Boston, or because when it comes to playoffs, it's totally different.
Yeah.
So what do you think?
Well, man, like Milwaukee's a beast. Like, so they're doing exactly what you saw with LeBron, but even scarier. So they brought in a new head coach, which the Raptors were trying to pursue last year, right? And he's actually good, right? We probably didn't think of it at the time, but he's good.
I wanted him for the Sixers, so, so it'd be different with the Sixers.
What do you guys think about the current front court lineup that they have with Siakam and Ibaka? Do you think they should keep this kind of front court starting lineup and then Gasol off the bench, or should they at some point even think about bringing
him? I don't know, man. I feel like you had Serge Ibaka at the five playing the best basketball of his career in a way. Mm-hmm. And then you had Pascal Siakam just like minds out. He's going to be most improved player for sure.
I think so, yeah.
And it's like, how do you switch that up? Because I think in one way, Pascal could go on the bench and he can create his own shot. Yeah. Yeah. He's shooting threes right now. He's off the ball. He's dribbling. Like, he's doing it all.
Yeah.
But I don't think Marc Gasol can really do that to the same extent. So it's like, do you have Gasol be a little bit of a difference maker when it comes to the bench? Or do you have Pascal just completely own the second unit? Yeah. I don't know.
He can play as a center, though, to take off Ibaka. Yeah. I think when Marc Gasol... But his passing skills with Siakam will be perfect. Don't you think?
We've already seen it, man. Like Gasol.
Passing is really, Gasol like any, is the Gasol brothers passing. Are very good at passing.
I think what we're seeing right now is that Kawhi, the starting lineup of Kawhi, Danny Green, Lowry, with Ibaka and Siakam, they have the speed and they have the versatility to switch on different on pick and rolls.
Yeah.
But what Gasol brings off the bench is just that he's technically the best player every time that someone comes off the bench. Like the second unit lineup versus any second unit lineup, he's almost basically the best player. And he literally runs the show where he can pass. And he's literally the main kind of the offense that he runs the offense and is the main focus on the offense in terms of low post, high post. He can run any single kind of sets that you want, that you need him to run off the bench.
And he's experienced.
And it's working well for him. And he's a good defender off, and he's defensive anchor at the same time.
Do you guys think with JV in the mix and like looking at what his stats are in Memphis right now, he's killing it, right? Do you think Gasol is that significant of an improvement when we talk about his passing game, his defense? Like, JV wasn't as good at that side of the game.
When it comes to JV, he's very awkward. Yeah. When he plays, he's very awkward. When you see how he dribbles and stuff like that, like, you already know what's his next move. With Marc Gasol, there's triple trap. Like, he can pass, he can shoot 3 points sometimes, and he can like post up. Yeah. So that's the thing about Marc Gasol compared to JV. Yeah. JV can shoot, but like you can tell that where is he going when he dribbles
the
ball.
He's kind of aloof. Yeah. He's just kind of like lost out there.
He's more of a hustle kind of, like an Enes Kanter.
Yeah, he would have been so good in the 90s though.
Yeah, exactly.
He would have been, the difference really why they took that risk of getting Gasol was the fact that during the playoffs, the game slows down.
Yeah.
If you have a player that can get his own bucket at the through post-up, through a slow-down half-court game, which Gasol was perfect when they had the grit and grind in Memphis, that was his game. He excelled at that.
Yeah.
That's perfect to have because now you have two weapons that can kind of go post-up in one-on-one with Kawhi and Gasol. Yeah. And the difference is that Gasol can switch on pick and rolls, which they had trouble with JV. Every time they put him on, he can't switch on pick and rolls. He's too slow. He can't keep with guards. Whereas Gasol knows how to use his length, and he knows how to use his quickness. Not as quick, but he's a good defensive anchor. And then he adds that shooting and passing, which, you know, it's hard to get from a center nowadays.
Yeah.
Right? There's too many skilled big guys in the NBA, and one of them is Gasol. I mean, Jokic can basically at some point, Joel. It's not that many people that you can name with the kind of skills that Gasol has. So to make that trade, it was a no-brainer. But at the same time, it was a playoff move for the Raptors.
Yeah.
Because when the game slows down, you're going to need to have someone that you can put the ball in at the post, who can create mismatches, who can make that decision whether to pass, to shoot, or find the open man. That's Gasol is basically going to be their key.
But to me, it was actually a chess move, right? So we saw at the trade deadline.
Yeah.
those teams that you were talking about, Milwaukee, who looks super scary.
Yeah.
They add in Mirotić, right?
Yeah.
It's and then the East. It's right? Everyone is like
Tobias Harris underrated.
Yeah.
It's like, if you don't make a move now, it's like, are you really going all in right now? Because we know Kawhi might leave at the end of this year.
Do you think he's going to leave or he's going to stay?
It all depends on the results, man. Yeah.
It depends on what he wants. Yeah. We don't ever hear him talk.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So if we get to hear it from him.
See, the thing about Kawhi, he's kind of a wild card.
Yeah.
Like, with Clippers, they're all out for Kawhi, trading Tobias to the Sixers.
Yeah. Opens up cap space.
And then the Bomber watched the Raptors game in Toronto.
Yeah.
So that's right. Yeah, exactly. So they're all in for Kawhi. And then Kawhi bought the house in San Diego. Like, this is the same guy.
He's not going to commute 4 hours to get to LA.
This is the same guy that bought a car, 97 Chevy.
Yeah.
For him to invest money there, that's kind of like scratching on Toronto fans.
He grew up
like,
in the Los Angeles area. It's hard to predict him because you don't know exactly what he wants. Think about it. I don't think it's a matter of whether you win or not because he has won a championship. So he's the kind of player, like, I've already won a championship. Yeah. I've won an NBA champion MVP. Mm-hmm. So he basically has had the taste of what it's like to be in a championship team and to win a championship. So at this point, it's literally so, like, up to him. Like, it has nothing to do whether the Raptors play well or go far. It's just a matter of what he really wants, where he really wants
but
to play.
But I think he's starting to warm up to the team. Because, like, there's something that he said after that Boston game. Or actually, it might not have been Boston, but, like, one of the games this week. Yeah. And he was just like, you know, Kyle said we were going to win, and, you know, I believed him, right? And the fact that he's talking about Kyle, I always thought there was friction between those two because of DeMar and all of that
and
stuff.
Drama,
but it's starting to warm up to him. It's starting to warm up to Kyle, and I think they actually have a real chance of winning. Maybe not the whole thing, but at least the East.
Yeah, come back.
Should we worry about Bucks, though? Like, you guys think, should we worry about Bucks?
I should, too. Because they don't have an answer for Giannis. As good as Kawhi is, Giannis is too big, too strong at times for them to contain.
Yeah.
And it's harder now that you added another elite shooter in the team where you have literally 4 or 5 guys outside in the open that can shoot 25, 30 feet.
Not only 4 or 5 guys, but 4 or 5 like 7 foot guys.
Exactly. Yeah.
Chris Middleton,
Brook
Lopez.
Team.
Yeah. Very tall team.
Mirotić, Brogdon is an efficient shooter too. Yeah. It's hard to guard Giannis one-on-one.
And they still
already have
Bledsoe, right?
Yeah.
So, like, Bledsoe. that team's nasty.
I don't know if you should be scared, because at the same time when Bulls beat the Cavaliers, they were 3-1 in the season split. 3-1 in the season. But when it comes to the playoffs, the Cavaliers just wiped them out.
But when you watch the game, it was like, it felt like a playoff game where, it was a close game, and the Raptors played well, but the Bucks just had their numbers in terms of they just knew how to kind of use Giannis and just kind of how to isolate him on a mismatch and literally have the
court. And I think I think it was 2 years ago we played against the Bucks in the playoffs in the first round.
Yeah,
and you could tell he looked like a deer in headlights, right? But Giannis now is just like, if you saw him when he was a rookie, he was super scrawny.
Yeah,
and then this year he's built.
I think
out
now he knew how to use his size, and he built up. In terms of his strength and his ability to get in to move that laterally, to move that quickly and to move that fast in that body size.
He has a 3-point shot, it's over.
Oh my god.
The difference between I think Raptors just need to find a way, kind of like Boston did last year.
I think Gasol is going to make a difference in terms of the inside presence, interior defense, because once you can
don't forget about Jeremy Lin, right? I feel like he's going to add some experience to the team. And you think about our point guards right now, we got Kyle Lowry's got a back problem, we got Fred VanVleet who's got a back problem, thumb problem, You're kind of injured at guard.
He was a good replacement for DeLon too.
Well, Jeremy Lin is kind of the player that you want.
Yeah.
But what you need is Van Fleet, who can just, like you said earlier, slow the team down. Because he's very, just move the ball around. Something about Raptors. That's a good thing about Raptors is they move the ball around. Except when Kawhi comes back. Sometimes he's kind of rusty when he comes back. And then he's doing the ISO. But
You don't have to worry about Kawhi.
Yeah,
he's good. You put him in the fourth quarter of the playoffs, you're good. You're good. Just let him do his thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, that's all we have, guys, for our show tonight. I hope you guys enjoyed our segment. Anything you guys want to say before we end? The cameras are right there.
Guys, shout out. Basketball is life. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Where can they find you on Instagram? What's your handle?
At Avish Sood, Instagram handle. Follow me. I got some good content sometimes.
Awesome. Any last words you want to say, James?
Thanks for having me again. And just follow me in JamesMania07.
Awesome. Yeah. And don't forget, guys, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, you can find us, Pinoy Crossover. Other than that, guys, stay ballin'.